40th number of Psalm. I waited patiently for the Lord, and he inclined to me and heard my cry. He also brought me up out of a horrible pit, out of the miry clay, and set my feet upon a rock and established my goings, and he has put a new song in my mouth. Praise to our God. Many will see it and fear and will trust in the Lord. It is with certainty that I say to you this morning that all of us have faced or will face adversity in our lives.
Yes, sir.
If you are alive, you will experience hardship.
Yes, sir.
Somewhere along the line, trouble is going to knock at your door. And guess what? Even if you don't answer, trouble's still going to come in. We go through some tough times, don't we? It is Job who said in the 14th chapter, the first verse, that man is born of woman and is a few days. And those few days are what? Full of trouble. Somebody said amen. And I want you to know that most of the trouble that you and I experience, we're the cause. We're the blame. I know that there are many who like to point the finger. And we want to blame the man. We want to blame the boss. We want to blame the teacher. We want to blame the weather. We want to blame the economy. But most of the trouble we experience is because, number one, we make bad decisions. I don't know about you, but in my life, I can trace most of my trouble to just bad decisions. I did what I wanted to do versus what was wise, what was right, or what God wanted me to do. Another source of trouble is because we possess the bad attitude. Huh? Sometimes you can even make a good decision, but have a bad attitude about what you're doing, and the wrong attitude will get you in trouble. I tell my children often that you can avoid a lot of the hardships at home and get more privileges and more respect and more things to go your way if you just get the right attitude. If I ask you to do something and you do it with an attitude, it really doesn't count. A lot of the trouble we experience, you want to get promoted on the job, but you got a bad attitude. Sometimes we have bad reactions. Somebody does something to us in the way we react. See, but we get stuck on, but they did this to me. Or we listen to the crowd. Man, you let them do that to you? And we react, we go off. You know how we say, I'm going to lay my religion down. Or, you know, I'm only human. But sometimes your bad reaction gets you in trouble. There's a whole lot of folk unemployed today because of a bad reaction. There are a whole lot of people that have gone to the hospital because of a bad reaction. There are folk dead because they reacted to situations. And you just can't go off on everything. You just can't get mad. You know, somebody cut you off in traffic. You better let that rage settle down. Just turn up your music and keep praising God, because road rage. There was a story of two men not too long ago on the freeway. One cut the other one off. They both come up the exit, and they get out, and they both end up going to the same either service station or car wash. I think it was a car wash. And they get to argue. Before you know it, they both were armed, and they both shot each other. One of them died. 50 and 40 years old, two men who just because somebody cut somebody off. The wrong reaction will get you in trouble. Then we listen to bad advice. You know, the Bible says, blessed is the man who doesn't walk in the counsel of the ungodly. And a whole lot of us, we listening to ungodly advice, ungodly counsel. And, you know, I wouldn't take that. Go, this is what I do. And the same people giving you the bad advice, if you really check, their situation is worse than yours. And then, of course, you're right, Mother Gibbons. And then, of course, we get into these bad relationships. That'll cause you some trouble, won't it? You get hooked up with the wrong man or the wrong woman. Sometimes we're the cause of our trouble, but sometimes trouble comes and you had nothing to do with it. My Bible tells me that Job was perfect and upright. He feared God. He shunned evil. Every day he prayed for him and his children. That God bragged about Job. Hey, anybody like my servant Job? Nobody like him on the face of the earth. But yet, when Satan got permission from God and came against him, Job got sick. Job lost his family. Job lost his fortune. Job's wife went off on him. Listen, Job saw trouble and it wasn't none of his fault. And if you really want to see the prime example of trouble coming your way and it's not your fault, look at Jesus. Trouble is a part of the journey of life, and the truth of the matter is when you come to Christ, trouble doesn't stop. Amen. In fact, sometimes trouble escalates when you become born again. We were talking to Brother William downstairs about this journey, and we wanted to make no bones about it. Brother William, this acceptance of Christ, this new life in Christ doesn't mean your trouble is over. In fact, your troubles might escalate, but the difference is you can make it through your trouble with God. Adversity is a part of the Christian life. Acts 14:21 says that the disciples in the early church, when they had preached the gospel in the city of Antioch, they said they made disciples, they returned to Lystra, Iconium, in Antioch, strengthening the souls of the disciples, exhorting them to continue in the faith, saying, we must go through many tribulations to enter the kingdom of heaven. Make no mistake, you're going to catch trouble if you're a child of God. If you let your light shine, you're going to suffer persecution. In the book of Timothy, 2 Timothy, 3rd chapter, 12th verse, yes, all those who desire to live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer or must suffer persecution. 1 Peter 4 and 12 says, don't think it strange, beloved, concerning the fiery trial, which is to try you, as though something strange has happened to you, but rejoice to the extent that you are partakers of Christ's suffering, that when his glory is revealed, that you may also be glad with exceeding joy. In other words, when you, the Christian, are in trouble, your light is shining, and people see you not only enduring trouble, but overcoming trouble, and then God gets glory, and you get joy. God gives us principles in the Word to help us deal with trouble. How do you go through dark days? How do you go through times of adversity? Psalm 41 through 3 is a perfect framework to help us, to lead us, to guide us through trouble. Now, contrary to what most people think, they think that when you read this psalm, that it's a psalm about the salvation experience. It really is not. This is a psalm of David, who knew God, who trusted God, and he's really talking about the Christian experience. And in Christ, you'll find that you'll have some dark days, but this is the way that a person who believes in God and trusts God, it's his testimony. David is the author of this psalm, and it didn't say what it was that David experience that made him write this psalm, but David's story is filled with experiences that could have been the prompter of him writing this psalm. Listen, when he served under King Saul, and he was faithful and tried to bless Saul, and the more he tried to bless Saul, the more jealous Saul was of David, and he tried to kill David simply for being David. During the darkness of his life, he experienced, particularly after the grievous sin that he committed with Bathsheba, killing Uriah, her husband, and birthing a child. And you know Psalm 51, where he pours out his heart for forgiveness. It could have been that experience. It could have been the rape of his daughter Tamar by his son Amnon, which was her half-brother. You're talking about dark days. Then David's other son Absalom murdered Amnon for doing what he did to his sister. So trouble on top of trouble. It could have been when Absalom decided that he was going to overthrow his father David on the throne. You don't hear me. When the son comes against the father. Even after David had forgiven him. Could have been the rebellion of Sheba. It could have been a lot of things. Your trouble may not be like David's trouble, but as Christians, I know you've experienced some trouble. Maybe a loved one died. I know that it's hard when somebody you love, even if they're Christians, it's hard. Maybe you lost your job. I don't know if you've ever had the experience of going in and getting that pink slip, that 2-week notice. Maybe your relationship with your spouse is on the rocks and you've experienced separation or even divorce. That's hard. Maybe you suffered financial difficulty. There were a lot of folks who came through 2008 and 2009 who found their retirement gone, their savings gone, and they went from financial wellness to financial ruin. All right. And then maybe there's just that personal failure. I don't know about you, but I've had personal failure where I've just sinned and I just disappointed God, disappointed myself, disappointed others. That's dark. But David gives us a framework where we can make it through dark days. And I'm just going to share the framework that he outlines here. The first thing is you need to practice your faith. And Brother William, what it means is you got to believe God and you got to put your faith into action. You just can't say you're a Christian. You got to be a Christian. You just can't know the word. You've got to do the word. You've got to trust the word. You've got to live the word. It says, I waited patiently for the Lord. David waited patiently for God. He put his faith and trust in God. This word wait means to look for, to hope, to expect. He didn't simply wait for God. He had his hope in God. He trusted God. He was earnestly expecting God to show up. And as Christians, what we've got to quit doing when trouble comes is quit saying, oh me, oh my, and quit throwing our hands up and pulling our hair out. What we got to do is wait for God to show up. We got to look for God on the horizon. You got to wait patiently for the Lord. As the Bible says, or as the old saying says, he may not come when you want him, but he'll show up be on time. Mary and Martha will tell you, he may not come when you want him. He may not come while your brother's living. He may not come when it seems like everything can still be solved. Maybe it looks like your problem is past solving, but when God shows up, he's always on time. Listen, the scriptures say faith comes by hearing, but strength and power comes by doing. You got to practice your faith. You just can't think that God will show up. You got to know, and you got to lean on that thing that God will. what? You got to do it. Look, the Bible this morning in Sunday school, be ye doers of the word, not hearers only. God isn't giving us pithy sayings just to pin up on our bulletin board. He's giving us principles for what? Living. Faith without works is dead. Faith without action is dead. Faith requires a response. It requires that you do something. Even though it said waited patiently, it didn't mean he didn't do anything. He had to exercise his faith. The psalmist waited. Waiting is an inward disposition that David describes. He continued with his outward responsibilities as king. He continued with his activities as a man of God, but he was assured that God would soon show up and deal with his situation. So just because trouble comes, a loved one dies, a spouse leaves, a job is gone, your money goes, don't stop working, don't start serving, don't stop doing. You got to keep on being a spouse. You got to keep on being a student. You got to keep on being a good employee. Keep on being a good church member. Keep on being a good neighbor, a good friend. You got to keep on working and ministering and laboring and giving and doing what God tells you to do. You've got to practice your faith. That's how you deal with dark days. You trust and you wait and you patiently look for God to show up. And then it says, I waited patiently for the Lord, and he inclined to me and heard my cry. Heard my cry meant that David called on God. So the second thing you need to do is pray. David expressed his pain, his misery, his anguish to the Lord. He sought his help. He cried out to God. I don't know if you've ever been in that kind of trouble. That calling out to God trouble, where you lay on the living room all by yourself and give God your heart and give God your soul. I don't know, but it's good sometimes just to get by yourself and call on God. You know, it's good to have friends where you can call. I can call Tony and share Tony my burdens, and I can call my boys and share my trouble. I can go to Kathy and share my pain, but sometimes I've got to get on my knees and go to God and give God my heart. He said he cried to the Lord. And it said he inclined. You know, this whole faith thing and this prayer thing work together. When you pray, it said pray without wavering. Any man who come to God wavering, don't expect God to answer your prayer. Pray believing. It said he called on the Lord. He knew God heard because it said God inclined his ear. It paid off.
Yes, sir.
Think about it. God's on the throne in heaven. And you start praying. And God does like this. Isn't that what David just said? He just said, he inclined to me. He leaned over to pay attention to me. It's good to know that God hears my prayer. I don't care. There's 7 billion people on the earth, and if a quarter of them were Christians and all of them were praying at the same time, God would still hear my prayer. That's the kind of God I serve. Listen, all the Christians can pray at the same time and you still get God's undivided attention. That's the God I serve. It's good to know that God hears our prayer when we pray in faith. When trouble comes or distress comes and when panic comes, some folks throw pity parties and temper tantrums. They pitch a fit, but the correct response for the Christian is to get on your knees and pray. Prayer is a time not only to throw your cares on God, which he tells us to do. He said, cast your cares on me because I care for you. But it's also a time just to commune with God. It's just good to be with God. It's just good to know God, to be in his presence, to be able to say, God, I'm your child. I'm all yours. It's good to be before the throne of God. Listen, the angels are there worshiping God, but they don't have the same kind of relationship that you have with God. You can get in his presence, have a dialogue with the creator and master of the universe. the one who created all things, made by him and for him, the God who made all the galaxies, the billions of galaxies, each that have billions of stars, who God holds them all together at the word of his power, you can have a dialogue with him. The Bible instructs us to pray. Jesus prayed. The Bible says in Mark 1:35 that it was early in the morning and he got up before daylight. He went out to a solitary place and there he prayed.
Yes.
Luke 6:12 says it came to pass that he went out to the mountain and prayed and continued all night in prayer. Paul and Silas, when they were in prison in Acts the 16th chapter, it said that when they were in the darkness of the prison, they weren't in one of these prisons that got the TVs and the gyms and three meals a day. They were chained in the stocks. They were chained against the cold, jagged walls of a dirty prison where they didn't have restroom facilities. They had to go right there, and they had all kinds of rodents and things and darkness, and there they were, having been beaten, having been in this wretched position with your muscles begin to seize up and your throat begin to get dry with thirst, and they were there at midnight in the darkness and in the pain, and they began to pray and sing to God. I think that's an example for some of us to follow. And then there was Peter who said, look, if you just humble yourself under the mighty hand of God, that he may exalt you in due time, casting all your cares on him because he cares, we need to pray. Then in the second verse here in Psalm 40, it says we need to persevere through the difficult circumstances. Look, he also, not only did God hear me, but he also brought me up out of the horrible pit, out of the miry clay, and set my feet upon a rock and established my going. When trouble comes, don't wilt, don't crumble, don't fall, don't lose it. Trust God, and God will bring you out. You can make it with God. Even the most trying circumstances of your life, the darkest day, no matter what challenge you face, I'm here to let you know that you can make it, you can persevere, you can keep on fighting, you can keep on serving and do the will of the Lord. You can make it with God.
All right.
One of the darkest days of my life, as my beloved wife and I were trying to start a family, and my wife being pregnant with twin boys, and looking at that lovely lady with that glow on her face, only to, I was with her for some miraculous reason, as God would have it, I was with her, helping her, when all of a sudden one of the sacks around my twin sons burst. And we went to the hospital, and for a 10-day journey there, my wife laid with these two twin boys in her womb, one who was fully viable, but the other in full distress. And the doctor said, listen, there's nothing we can do. It has to heal itself. And by the way, since they're paternal twins, if one doesn't make it, they both won't make it. And for 10 days, here, this young man who always wanted to be his wife's knight in shining armor, who wanted to be in charge and show his wife that he's the man, could stand by and do nothing. And then had to call on God in my darkest hour. And sometimes when you call on God, I want you to know something. You don't always get what you ask for. I prayed for God to save my boys, and yet God, in his great providence, allowed them to make passage from earth to eternity. And I remember going to the chapel and getting a faith check and having to call on the Lord in my darkest hour. And had to come to the church the next morning and listen, had to preach to the congregation. And God sometimes will take your pain and give you a testimony. Because the sermon that morning was, I will trust in the Lord. spirit of five is in the two. The two that I have, the joy that they bring, the joy of having a son and a daughter like Kendall and Kaylin. God will hear your prayer. We didn't get it immediately, but we had to persevere. We had to go through. We went through another with my daughter. The same thing. But God, won't he show up? Won't he make it all right? Psalmist said that the Lord will deliver you. He'll bring you through. He'll make a way somehow. David said in Psalm 34:4, I sought the Lord and he heard me and delivered me from all my fears. Psalm 34:17, the righteous cry out and the Lord hears and delivers them out of all their trouble. Your deliverance may not come the way you want it, but he'll deliver you. Psalm 34:19, many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivers him out of them all. Notice he didn't promise that we'd avoid trouble, but he promised to take us through it. Psalm 30:5 says, for his anger is but for a moment, but his favor is for life. Weeping may endure for a night, but joy comes in the morning. I know all of us know the 23rd number of Psalms. David declared that the Lord is his shepherd.
Yes, sir.
This morning, Brother William declared that the Lord is now his shepherd. And I want you to know he's a God who provides. He said, I shall not want. But God doesn't only provide, but he protects and he empowers. It says, yea, though I walk. What? Through the valley of the shadow of death. That's a bad place. A valley of the shadow of death. That's a rough place. That's a mean place. That's a lonely place. That's a painful place. But yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. Why? Because thou art with me. Why? Because he himself has said, I will never leave you, nor will I forsake you. Thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. The place where the psalmist was delivered from was a horrible pit. It was a terrible state of affairs. It was a helpless and a hopeless situation. He said it was a horrible pit, the miry clay. But it said he brought me up. You know, when God delivers, he brings you up. When you trust in the Lord and persevere, you go nowhere but up, because God is an upbuilding God. God is an up-blessing God. The state of Job after his trouble was twice as blessed as before his trouble. I'm here to tell you, when you trust God and wait on God and call on God and persevere, God will bring you up. He said he didn't even only bring him up, he brought him out with his mighty hand, and then he said he gave him sure footing. He said he brought me up out of the miry pit, out of the horrible pit, out of the miry clay, and set my feet upon a rock. You know, you can't get nowhere in miry clay. You can't get nowhere in a pit. But when God sets you on a rock, now you got solid footing. Now you can walk. Now you can get somewhere. Now you can go. Now you can move, because you've got sure footing. When you're in Christ, when God brings you out, you get stability and sure footing in your life. I'm a living witness. I was sharing with Brother William about when rock bottom, I hit it. And then the bottom fell out of rock bottom. And I was in a bad place. But I called on the Lord. And when the Lord heard my cry and brought me up out of that horrible pit and set my feet on a rock, I've been steadily moving and steadily climbing ever since. It hasn't been easy, but I've been moving. It hasn't always been good, but I've been moving. It hasn't always been the way I wanted to be or as fast, but I've been moving, and I've been moving on up. He'll give you stability. You got to persevere. Paul gives us the same encouragement in Romans 8. He says, look, in Romans 8, you've got too much going for you not to be able to make it. Think outline these folks. I could preach on Romans 8. This is what Romans 8 tells you you have. God's unfathomable pardon. God's indwelling spirit. God's everlasting presence. God's abiding peace. God's unfailing plan. God's unwavering support. God's almighty power. God's unlimited generosity. God's unceasing intercession. When God gives us all this, you can't lose. Look at what Paul says in the 35th verse of chapter 8 of Romans. What shall separate us from the love of God? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? Any kind of trouble you can name, you can slip into that verse. It says, as it is written, for your sake, God, we are killed all the day long. We are counted as sheep for the slaughter. In other words, Lord, when I'm living for you, I might catch trouble, but hey, I'm willing to go through it for you. Yet, this is what the Bible says, in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. Notice it didn't say out of all these things. While you're in your trouble, you already are more than a conqueror. Somebody better get that one. We can't quit. We can't stop. We can't lose hope. With all of this going for us, how can we lose? Nothing can defeat us. Nothing can stop us because we serve an unstoppable and unbeatable God. Through the storms and the rains and the troubles and the trials and the tribulations, the challenges, the difficulties, the problems, the roadblocks, the obstacles, the failures, the heartaches, the miseries, the haters, the backbiters, the enemies, we are going to make it because we are more than conquerors through Christ. Some of us are in a horrible pit. Some of us are in a bad place. Some of us are in a horrible state of affairs, a helpless and a hopeless situation. But God is wanting you to know this morning that he'll bring you out. You got to practice your faith. You got to pray. And you've got to persevere. And then he'll put your life together for you and put you on sure footing. But that ain't all. There's one other thing you've got to do. When God does all that for you, there's still something left to do. That's to praise God. Verse 3 says, he has put a new song in my mouth, praise to our God. Many will see it and fear and will trust in the Lord. As God allows or causes trouble and trials, and tribulations in our life, and as he delivers us out of them all, we should acknowledge God's goodness through the praises and the worship and the adulation and the exaltation. We should have a new song and a fresh testimony to give to God. The psalmist was given an occasion for a new and fresh praise. Listen, that's why David said this in Psalm 34. I will bless the Lord at all times, and his praises shall continually be in my mouth. Listen, God has done enough for me today to praise him all day long. And when I start praising him tomorrow, I don't have to praise him for what he did for me today, because there are going to be some new blessings tomorrow to praise God for. Listen, 1 Thessalonians 5:18 says, in everything, give thanks. Even before God delivers you, give thanks. God's will for us in Christ Jesus is to give him thanks. On your good days, thank him. On your bad days, thank him. When you're up, thank him. When you're down, thank him. When you're on mountain high, thank him. When you're in valley low, thank him. When you got big bank, thank him. When you're broke and disgusted, thank him. If you're healthy, thank him. When you're sick, thank him. When you're between a rock and a hard place, thank him. When you're living on easy street, thank him. Thank God. He'll put a new song in your mouth. Sing songs of praise. Sing songs of hope. Listen, there's that song that says, I've had some good days. wish I could sing it this morning. I got God in my heart. God gave Jesus Christ, his son, to die for my sins, to save my soul, and to get me eternal life. Hasn't God been good to you? Didn't he save you? Didn't he wash you? Didn't he fill you with the Spirit? Didn't he seal us to the day of redemption? Didn't he bring us up out of the horrible pit, out of the miry clay? Hadn't he picked us up when we were down? Hadn't he brought you out when you were left out between a rock and a hard place? Hadn't he made a way for you out of no way? Hasn't he given you joy in the midst of your sorrow? Hasn't he given you peace in the midst of your pain? Hasn't he given you joy unspeakable and full of glory? He's provided all of your needs according to his riches and glory. He's been a friend that sticks closer than a brother. And when he does all that, I can't sing the blues. I've got to sing how great thou art. I've got to sing love lifted me. I've got to sing I was sinking deep in sin. Far from the peaceful joy, very deeply stayed within, sinking to rise no more. But the master of the seas heard my despairing cry. From the waters lifted me, now save them out. Love lifted me, love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me. I know you had to sing the blues sometime, but when you get the urge to sing the blues, next time sing Amazing Grace. How sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Blind, but now I see. Oh, Jesus Christ, he died 2,000 years ago on Calvary's tree. Didn't he die for you? Didn't he die for me? My sin, every lie, Every bad act, every word of profanity, everything I ever done wrong, God died for me. He set me free. He took away the pain and the penalty. One day he's going to take me from the very presence of sin. He put a new song in my mouth. Listen, Brother William, I want you to know you can make it with God. I want you, brothers and sisters, to know Brother William's on the first day of his journey, but some of you might have been on your journey for 30 and 40 years. You still need to know you can make it with God. If you are here today and you have not accepted Christ as your Savior, we're here to extend to you an invitation. If you are here today and you have church membership but no relationship with God, I'm here to let you know you can make it today, but you gotta make it with God.